see you there. Today, legends, we're going to do the swivel hubs on this V8 Ruby. It's the follow-up of the trailer you saw the other day. So I'm going to try and do a step-by-step, you know, close enough procedure for you guys today. So we'll get stuck into it. Just going to start by removing the wheel nuts. Always bend at the knees when you put these down because they are bloody heavy. Righto, we're just going to remove the caliper now. There's two 17mm bolts at the back. So, just start by getting these out. On some of the earlier Troopies, they actually had a hard metal brake line and you actually had to disconnect your brakes to remove the caliper, which was really annoying. So, this makes it much easier. Oh, my cameraman's gonna love cleaning up this stuff later. So sometimes the caliper might be a bit stuck. If you've got a little bit of a lip, you can just prise the caliper up. If it is too hard, you may have to push your pistons back a little bit. Rags is a big key in this job. So many rags or gloves. You'll probably see me with a combination of both because I get sick of wiping my hands. I just like taking the gloves off. All right, guys, just gonna take the freewheeling cap off. Always make sure it's in free mode, not lock. Otherwise, when you pull it out, you're gonna have a bad time. Come in nicely like that, so if you lock it, it'll actually jump out and it can remain stuck inside. So now we're gonna take the... I don't know what the fuck it's called.
And the housing?
Yeah, I don't know. Seriously. Yeah, but I can't edit your fucking bullshit noises out. Okay, so now we're going to take the housing off once we remove the cap. There's a trick to these. Leave them a couple of threads on still. Because we're going to have to tap them out. Okay, so I'm gonna try a soft face hammer here because normally if you use a big hammer it can wreck it. These little cones here lock in and stop the, you know, if they all come loose it'll actually hold it in place and they'll also locate it. And the easiest way to get these out if they remain stubborn, just give them a... swift hit and they'll come loose. If you use a hard face hammer, they will come loose a lot easier, but it'll usually damage your housing at the same time. So most of the times you find these will be absolutely hammered. But this is the first time this one's been done, so everything should be really nice and easy. If you've got a habit of losing nuts and bolts, get a parts tray. Put all your nuts and bolts in a parts tray. I've been doing this long enough, I should know where everything goes. And inside here, there's a retaining ring. That little fella in there. Right, so now we're gonna remove the circlip from inside that holds the CV joint into the hub. Can be a little bit tricky. Sometimes you'll need a screwdriver or something like that to help get it out because they're a nightmare. Success. That's a little bastard right there. Sometimes they're actually easy to get in, come on out to get out. So now this just pulls out. If you can save your gasket, save it. If not, there'll be a new one in the kit. You can't have too many spare gaskets though. So the end of your CV goes in there and just spins when you're freewheeling. Alright guys, just going to remove the lock nut now. Now you have a lock nut, a lock washer and then another lock nut. The washer will fold over the first lock nut and back over the second lock nut. And there's a little convex in the spindle which the lock nut locks into to stop it from spinning, which locks everything together. Just said lock a lock now. So what you do is you find where your tab is, give it a tap, try and bend it over, get your tool, I think it's a 54mm socket, possibly. They're relatively cheap, from your local four-wheel drive enthusiast shop. Might even give Phil Trotman a spiel. Oz 4x4 Adventure. There we go. Lock nut number one. Oops. Always like to wipe this stuff down as I'm putting it away, otherwise you just dirty everything. Now, over time, some bastards probably hit it with a cold chisel or something like that and always reckon, but this one's really good because obviously it's never been done. This is the lock washer I was talking about. That's where it was folded over the other lock nut. That's where I mashed it up to get off. So say that screws on the inside, that'll hold it shut there like that. And then you'll obviously pull one forward over the next one. So now there's another lock nut in here. Now we're not replacing the wheel bearings on this one. We're just gonna repack them for the service. But we'll do a video at another point of replacing the wheel bearings. But I'll include repacking them on this one. Can't show you all my secrets at once. Now, obviously, I'll do things differently than the next guy. I don't care. If you want to do it differently, do it differently. I'm showing you how I do it. So this is the whole hub assembly with wheel bearings, everything intact. I'm just going to put this down. Now that's off, we'll get some more footage of that later when I repack the bearings. So now here we have the spindle. This is actually your CV joint. So when you hear about CV joints breaking, it'll be this little bugger here, this little drive all the way to your diff. And all it locks that in is your from that little freewheeling lock. That's all it joins it to your front hub for drive. Obviously that won't spin when it's not in four-wheel drive, but when it's in four-wheel drive, that'll always turn regardless of the hub's locked in or not. So now we're gonna start taking this off. Now, be really careful when you pull this apart because there's so many layers that everything goes into. If you misplace a felt with a metal ring or anything like that, you can lose yourself really quickly. So try and do one side at a time. So if you do stuff it up, you've got somewhere to go. Now I believe this is 160,000 Ks. May not seem much, but I mean, if you go off road as much as this guy does, then
you know, could be the equivalent of 300,000 k's driving up and down the freeway. Now these are all done. There's nothing really holding that spindle on. It could fall off at any second now, but it should have a nice good seal to it. So that's one, two. So this is your spindle. There's a brass bush in the back of your spindle. Later model Troopers will have these little needle roller bearings inside. Early ones will just have a solid brass bush all the way through. They usually wear out before your it'll wear out your CV joint. So all we're going to do is just clean this, pack a bit more grease back into that needle roller, and we'll be on our way. So this is your CV joint, or your Burfield joint. This is your swivel hub. As you can see, the grease is just, it's like water. It's no good. This is where it starts getting messy. Yeah, depending on the angle of the, that's your CV there. Depending on the angle of the vehicle, will determine whether you're gonna have diff oil pour out once it clears this seal area. This is a little bit of an angle going the other way, so you should be right. What I usually like to do is just cover these up and put them out of the way until I wanna attack it later. All right, so now we're gonna move this steering arm and also remove these four at the bottom. Now they're the same setup as the cones on the first hub, that is on a larger scale. This is what retain your actual kingpin or swivel hub bearings. There will be shims, top or bottom. Crucial, you put them back the way that you pull them out. So we're just gonna take the split pin and the castellated nut. And the same deal, don't undo it all the way. Get yourself a nice mash hammer. Now we're going to give it a nice good hit to here to loosen the taper. Once it's out, I'll show you the taper. Right there. Might just try it from a different angle. They can be stubborn, especially first time out. And that's got it. They can be hard. There's the taper I was talking about that will wedge itself inside and it will not come out. Same deal as before. This can be a little bit harder. Sometimes you will actually need to use a hard face hammer because it's just, in there. I'm not even really gonna bother with that. Might put on my PPE just in case. There's one out. Two out. Now the reason we leave the nuts on is in case you slip and you hit the thread and you put a big dint in it and cause yourself a world of pain.
believe that's fourth one loose.
Now also sometimes you'll remove these studs and the studs will actually come out with the nut. You will need to screw the stud back in with a stud installer. You can't just screw it back in with the nut on because it will never be tight. Even though it feels tight, it'll come loose again. The other reason we leave the nuts on is because if you hit these hard enough, your little cones will go flying. Might need a pair of pliers for this one.
Lovely. Here we go. One there, one there.
As I said, it's probably worthwhile investing in buying a box of these gloves because they're coming handy. Now this will still be held in because the actual bearing will be located in there. You can prise down it gently. Just be careful not to damage your shims. And if you do it evenly, it should be
without drama.
There it is. Right guys, now I'm gonna empty the swivel hub housing just with all this old grease. You'll go through a million rags if you try and do it with rags, so I just get a bit of newspaper. Just try and get as much of it out as I can. First. And do the rest with a rag or something like that. But yeah, this is, as I said earlier, it's like water, so. Now we're just going to take this top bearing off. A bit easier than the bottom one. So we'll just pop this one out, same as the other one, just be gentle. Just come out nicely, be careful of the shims. This is the shim that I was talking about earlier. Always make sure they go back the way they went in. Now what we're going to do is, on the back, we've got a heap of little 10mm bolts. We're going to undo them, that'll get our felts off, and that'll enable us to remove this assembly. We've got 6 bolts all up. Always make sure to keep these in order the way they come off, because these are another crucial part. You can't even see the bolts on this because they're so covered in grease. The bearings in this actually don't feel too bad. So we might just repack the bearings and just change the felts, put in your greasing, clean it all up. So that's how your hub comes off, all your swivel housing, and these are all your felts and everything like that. Always make sure they go on the way they come off. Dirty hands. So here, this is your swivel hub bearing. Easiest way to tell if these are worn out is by the markings shown inside that cone. You'll actually see there is a couple of marks in there, so I will change them. They aren't notchy yet, but there is marks there, and that's all it takes me to change them. So we'll go and clean all this up and come back to you. All right, so this is the lengthy process now. Cleaning all the housing up and getting all the grease and stuff off. So these parts washers are a really good investment. So if you ever seen one special or super cheap or anything like that, you know, get one. I just run kerosene in mine. It's relatively cheap and it does a good job. So yeah, this will keep me busy for the next half an hour or so. Righto guys, now we're gonna remove the inner axle seal and the two bearing cones, which hold your swivel hub bearings in place. I've just noticed here there's a bit of corrosion just around the back of this knuckle here. So might just give that a rough up before we put it back together, because that can rip felts to pieces in no time. But we'll deal with that shortly. So first thing we'll do is we'll get this axle seal out. Now, if you haven't got one of these, they're a great investment. It's only 10, 15 bucks. It says hook it in on your seal and give it a tap, and usually it'll sort of come out. Sometimes it takes a few goes, or it'll rip your seal to pieces. There we go. Seal's out, took a couple of goes, but she came out. Now there is a lot of greasy, oily stuff inside that diff housing, so I'd say that the seal was leaking, getting grease or oil into the grease and causing a bit of mayhem. So we'll clean that out shortly. Now next on the list is to get these bearing cones out, which are quite easy. Just a bit of a. There's two little cutouts in here. And that's one bearing cone out. So this is the bottom one. I didn't have a look at the bottom one before, but just wanted to check the condition. Now this one's actually got some pitting in there. I don't know if you can sort of see that or not. This is a bit of all that pitting there. That's the reason why we change these. Some people just reckon throw bearings in them, but change a whole lot. So that's the bottom one out. One's just a reverse procedure. Job done. All right, so now we're gonna install these new cones. Now, if you wanna see what they look like, there's not a, they're perfectly machined surface. There's no pits, imperfections, anything like that. Get yourself soft face hammer. Just sort of square it up a little bit. See how I do it? You can do it differently. You can use a block of wood, you can use a brass hammer. That a clean up in a second, but that's pretty much how you do it now. What I might do is get a block of wood with a harder hammer and give it a tap down, but that's pretty much how you get them in. What I'm doing now is just getting some sort of worn emery paper and just cleaning up that rough spot on the back here. I'll just use a bit of CRC for lubricant and just get the bulk of that rust off. Feel sort of a nice smooth surface all the way around. And wouldn't worry about it too much after that. Okay, so now I'm gonna install the inner axle seal. Now, most seals, they'll have like a flat surface on one side and open surface on the other side. Usually pay attention which way it comes out. 99.9% of the time they'll go in that way with that side facing out. Try and get yourself a nice even fit socket, or there's probably an installation tool you can buy. I've never really had any dramas doing it this way, so I'll just sort of sit it in there and tap it in place with the soft face hammer. So there we go. Once it sort of gets near in, you can almost just hit it with a flat surface. That high pitch noise you could just sort of hear then was when the surface touched the axle housing inside, which means the bearing is pushed all the way in. Now I'm just going to give it a wipe, and you feel it with your finger on the surface that's actually gone into, and it should feel uniform all the way around. Yeah, looks good to me. So the new felts are about to go on. So the felt will go on first, because you can always put the little lock rings on later. Be careful not to tear it as it goes on. Then you've got your sealing O-ring, or whatever you want to call it. Now it does have a lip on it. The pointed lip faces inside, so it crushes up against the this felt ring here. Let's get that in there. And this ring here, just give it a peel on and just sort of close it back up to where it was. Then we'll repack the bearings, put the swivel housing back on, and bolt it all back together. Okay, so now we're going to grease up the bearings. Now I'm old fashioned, I'll do it the old fashioned way. You can buy a fanned angle tool that'll do it. You just end up with a bit of grease in the palm of your hand, you get your bearing within your finger, and you literally just knead it in like that until it starts to come out the top. So once I've sort of done this a few times, you'll see the grease starting to come out the top. That means it's gone all the way through. And you rotate, do the next one, rotate, do the next one, and so on, and so on. Alright, time to put the swivel housing back on. Now you've got to put the bottom bearing in sort of underneath so it can fit into its little home. Usually what I'll do is sort of sit up in here and just sit it on like that. Alright, so now we're going to put on the lower steering arm bearing retainer, I suppose you call it, and the top plate with our shim. I've just sort of got this half started, and I'll get a nut and washer on it. There's enough room. There may not be enough room just yet. Not just yet. That's okay. If we just give it a bit of a tighten up, that'll allow me to get another one on. Well, we've got a loose stud. So as soon as the stud's loose, we'll have to go and tighten that up, because if you do, if you proceed to go ahead with it, you're just gonna end up with a stud coming out. You can stop. Okay, so we're about to put our bearing retaining plates in, I suppose, I don't know, whatever you call them. Good thing to do is give these studs a bit of attention if you've got a reverse Torx bit. You know, just make sure they're all tight. I've done them all already. I'm just gonna put a. There's already one in there. Gonna put a nut, washer, and cone in. And we're just gonna do it up, just to sort of to pull that into place, and that'll allow me to get the top one in a lot easier, because they do slog around a little bit. Just gently, you don't want to sort of overdo it and get things caught. Now, this is the tricky part. Trying to get the bearing to line up in the top. Now I'll put some more comb washers and nuts on this bottom bit, tighten that up a bit more, and sort of just pull the whole lot together. If it doesn't want to go, don't force it. There's something holding it back. Now sort of lift this out of the way. So let's put this top one in now. So just do this up, it'll go a little bit tight. Next one, it'll be loose. So it gets tight, loose, tight, loose, tight. Just keep doing that. It'll pull itself into place. There'll be no damage to your bearing. The steering stop without wrecking my nice new gasket. And that's all nicely torqued up because of that shim. It cannot go any tighter, cannot go any looser. It's just all got through that shim. So you can do those up as tight as you want. I'm sure there's a procedure for it. I know what feels tight and what doesn't feel tight, so I'll go with that. Okay, so now that's tightened down. Swivel hub feels good. Feels nice and tight with the new bearings. We're gonna put the top plates on. We're gonna match all the back up, put the bolts in, and go from there.
can be a little bit tricky to get the...
So first in's the ring, the metal ring. Then we've got the rubber. The rubber O-ring next. That sits over the back. Then the felt, and then your two halves.
Okay, so this is a little bit harder to sort of get, but there's the metal ring inside. Then you've got your rubber O-ring with the arrow facing out, and then you've got your felt. The two rings, top half, bottom half. Just most important thing is when you put your bolts in, make sure they go through your felt and do them all up finger tight first. Drop bolts everywhere. But just, yeah, the most important thing is make sure when you put it in, it goes through the felt. Because if it doesn't, you're gonna have a bad time. Like that one there. Nearly missed that one. We're all human. All right, so now we're going to nip them up. We'll be ready to clean up the CV, give it a repack, throw it in.
Okay, so now you can see it's all done up. It's all nice and clean. You can see the surface where I got the emery paper out. There's an even felt all the way around. So yeah, should have no problems now at all. We'll just get that CV joint cleaned up and put in, and then we'll reconnect the steering arm and put the rest back together.
So I'm not actually going to remove the CV joint and clean it out because it just needs a repack. Nothing's failed. It's just a routine sort of maintenance. So I'm just going to get the grease, just feed it into the joint. Similar way to what you do a bearing. It will take more grease once I've filled the actual hub up as well. I know some of you are thinking, geez, you've left that hub pretty empty, but I actually get about two tubes of grease and put them in through that little hole at the end. Just saves having grease everywhere when I'm trying to put it back together. So, made a nice little mess there. Should be enough for the time being. Always put a bit of grease around that seal where the inner axle seal is gonna go on, and try not to rest it on that seal as it goes in, because you could possibly damage the seal itself. Some of these will only go in a certain way where the flats are. Here we go. Always make sure it's locked into the diff as well. Hasn't locked into the diff, you have to go a bit further. Now we'll get the spindle sorted out. So now I'm just getting some grease and I'm just rolling it back into those needle rollers that are in the bottom of this spindle. Also put some grease around this brass bush, because that actually applies pressure to the inner face of that CV joint. It will get grease in there, but you know, once you put it on there, it's guaranteed it's going to make contact. Now we'll just put our gasket in and throw the spindle back on. Okay, so we've just put our spindle on with our new gasket. Now there's another new gasket on this side. Then you've got the brake backing plate and also the seal for the back of the hub. These can be a little bit tricky to get back on because that's only just sitting there. So we'll see if we can get it sort of first go. If not, you probably won't see it. I'll just cut it all out. There might be a bit of swearing, some outtakes. Maybe when I do a best of, you can see all that. Won't be seeing it today, guys. Damn it, there's one there. Calm as a bitch. I may have forgotten something and someone will be watching this going, you're an idiot, but I think that's it. All right, so we'll get them all tight and I'll show you how to repack those bearings. All right, so now they're all tight. We'll get onto those wheel bearings. All right, guys, now we're looking at the hub. We're gonna repack the wheel bearings.
First thing we do is pop the back seal out, remove the bearings, we're going to wash the whole lot up, bring it back, pack it with new grease, put a new seal in, and throw it back together. So we'll start by popping the seal out, bearing, another bearing. We'll take this over to the parts washer and we'll just wash it all up and we'll come back here and recap. Alright, legends, after washing up those bearings, I've come to the conclusion that I would like to replace these. I did find some scoring on the outer race, which look, it probably is passable, but I did mention it to my customer and they said, look, if it needs doing, do it. So we're going to replace them. So now you're going to get the full repack, not just a wash and repack. So first thing we need to do now, this hub's been cleaned. So we need to punch out the bearing cones. So inside the cones here, there'll be little, there's little cutouts. So you can hit your cones out from the back. So I'm just hitting the back one out now. Cones out. Same deal goes to the front cone. There's four cutouts, so you can use all four. And that's that one out there. Now we're just going to wipe the inner of the hub out, where the races were sitting. Just to give you an idea, we'll show you this outer race here. I'm not sure if you can see, there's a couple little scuffies in there. A couple of those marks just there. And also you can see a nice little wear mark all in the center, that sort of bronzy looking color. Could be the chrome layer sort of starting to lose its outer edge, and also the same as these bearings, they sort of, it's like the chrome started to wear through back down to the copper. Yeah, they felt all right, but I wasn't 100% on them. So we've got some new quality Japanese bearings here. That'll be an outer. This one's going to be the inner. So the first thing we'll do is we'll put the races in, then we'll repack the bearings. Now, how do you get these in, you may ask? There's some really dodgy methods. You can, some people will find a big socket, some people whack them. You can use a extremely sharp pin punch and tap it all the way around, but you gotta be so careful you don't slip, because if you damage that surface, you'll be in all sorts of trouble. I've actually knocked up these old ones. Cut a slit in it, so as you're hammering it down, it actually closes up, and then you can knock it back out again. So if you try and follow an old one in with a new one, you'll never get it out. So, put these aside. So what I've actually got here is an old outer that I've cut with a bit of a groove in it, as you can see. So as you're hammering this in, the closes the hole up, it'll center the race, and you'll be able to tap this out no problems at all without doing any damage. So you can just sort of start tapping in. You can do it anyway, really. Careful not to hit the studs here. Feel when it's hard home, because you won't feel any give when you tap it, or just it'll be a real hard rebound. So that's hard home now. So we'll just pry the installation tool out. finally. So that's the first one done. We have the new rear. Now we'll just get this started with the soft face hammer. And then I can use the hard hammer on the other. Always do it evenly, otherwise it'll go in on an angle and you may damage the inside of the hub. So that's gone as far as it can go now. Just needs that little bit more so I know it's hard home. I'm happy with that. That's how you knock in the cones. Okay, so now we're gonna repack these new bearings. Same as the swivel hub bearings, palm forward grease, the bearing here. And pack until you see the new grease coming out. Once you've done that, move on to the next side and just keep moving. Just keep greasing. Okay, so before I put the bearing in, I'm gonna put a smear of grease on the cone, and I'll put the freshly greased bearing race in, then we're going to install a new bearing seal. We're going to repack the front bearing and then we'll throw it back on the car. Got the new hub seal here, we're just going to install that. There is a couple ways you can do it. You can hit the seal itself, you can get the old bearing, old seal, it's been a long day, and use that to sort of to tap in. Now there is two ways this can go, I should have pointed that out first. There is a step surface on one side and a flat surface on the other side. Step surface goes down, flat surface stays up. Can be a little bit tricky to get these started. Someone may have a better idea of putting that in. This works just as well as any. There's no damage to the seal. I've used the old seal. You can see it's installed. We're gonna repack the front one now and then we'll throw it in. Same procedure as the inner. Just doing this with the outer. Pack the new grease in until it comes out evenly all the way around. Once we're done there, we're just gonna pack a bit more grease into that hub so it's sort of a nice greasy environment. Another way I like to make sure these are packed is if you just sit there and push down on it, you'll see that nice Vegemite salada sort of twirl coming out of the cones. So I have already packed a little bit in here, so I'll just pack a bit more in. Sit that bearing in there, and we'll go over and fit it. Okay, so we've just put the hub on, disc rotor, hub assembly. This washer, now it's got a smooth side and a flat side. Flat side goes against the bearing, smooth side doesn't. There's a little locking that Convex we were talking about earlier. Sits in there. Still need to go on a bit more. First lock nut. Now the lock nuts are the same. There's a flat on one side and a curve on the other side. Flat goes towards the washer. Once that's done, we'll just get our tool. Now this is the part where you can have the proper kilogram torque gauge or whatever you want to use. I was never taught to use that. It's all by feel. So I do my wheel bearings by feel. I've never had a problem. As I said, someone's probably going to carry on about it, but haters are going to hate. I don't really care. So this first one is the crucial one because it sets your bearing preload. So I usually sort of, I'll do it up tight first, just so I know the bearings, everything's pushed in and squished, and you back it off. Then all I do, do it up till you feel just a bit of resistance, And just one more. That's it. And then I'll put the lock nut on. So we've got a new lock washer here. This will just slide on over that little convex as well. Now there'll be a flat that one of those little tabs will match up on, and we'll push that in once this other lock nut's on. And then once this lock nut's on, we'll pull one back over, and then she won't be coming undone. This 3-hour ratchet isn't good enough to do my final tension. Right, so now we're gonna push one of the tabs back and pull one of the tabs forward. So I found a flat on this side. So I'm just gonna get my hammer, give it a tap over. So it's nice and flat. And then I'll find another one under here, which is sort of roughly where I want it. That one there. Just move that out of the way. And just literally bend it up. Just gonna wipe the excess grease out of here. So I can put my little locking hub back on. So I've just put a new gasket on. Surface is clean. There'll be two little cutouts there for the dowels. So just slide it on gently. Might have to just rotate a little bit to line up with the CV, and then straight on. Get those cones back in. And then we'll get that tricky little circlet back on. Okay, so I'm just doing the final tension on these 40mm nuts now. Now the next part is to get that circlet on. Okay, so for this next step, you'll need a little metric bolt. I think it's like an M8 1.25 or something like that. So you can sit there pulling the CV joint, so you can actually get this little sucker over the top, because it's nearly impossible otherwise. There's always someone that's done it. I've done it occasionally, but realistically, it doesn't happen very often. Hardest bit is just trying to keep it there. So you do it. Circlip in. Let's give it a bit of a push pull. Make sure the circlip's locked in properly. It's not going to go anywhere. Take your little bolt out. We'll reinstall our locking assembly after I wrecked it the other day. Just putting a little bolts in the locking hub now. And once it's done up, we'll make sure that it actually works. Put the caliper on, the wheel on, and we're done for this side. Okay, so now I've bolted that freewheeling hub on. I'm just gonna lock the hub and listen for the disc turning, which I can hear it, so it means it's working. Undo it, no more diff noise. Now we're just gonna put the steering arm on, brake caliper. Just cleaned the rotor with some brake cleaner. Just sat the caliper on. I've just got the first bolt in the top here, which I can feel it's in. Just gonna get the second bolt in down under here, which is just all a reverse procedure of when you put it on. Alright, that's tight. I'll get the spanner on that in a minute. Just lock that down in there. I'll put the nut on there. And yeah, I've just tightened the caliper. I've just tightened the steering arm. Now, being a castellated nut, there'll be a hole through the tie rod end. So we're going to get a new split pin, put that through wherever it is, fold it under, we're going to trim and trim. That's it. Now that's done, we can fill a hub full of grease. So I've just removed this little fella here, just sits on top of the hub. I'm now going to fill it with two tubes of grease, and that'll lubricate the CV joint and in the inner hub. Once that's done, we'll put the wheel on and this side's done. Okay, so now everything's done, hub's full of grease. I ended up putting 1.5 tubes in instead of two. 1.5 was enough. Castellated nuts tight with a new split pin, brake caliper's tight, everything else is tight. So now it's time to put the wheel on, and that's how you do a sewer hub kit, legends.